All right, thank you very much for that. We're going to be in the Old Testament today in Judges, although we're not going to judge, but Judges chapter 6. Real quick, let's go through a couple things. The name of this message today is Give Me Three Steps, because if we could just dive in the Bible and we could have three steps that we could follow each and every week, that would really help us hopefully in our planning and in all the people we deal with and all the things that we do. But real quick, Rick, pickleball starts this next Saturday? Saturday at 5 p.m. If you've never played pickleball, it's a very easy game to learn. Rick will teach you. You don't need equipment. You just show up next door, 5 o'clock on Saturday, and they'll teach you everything that you need to know about it. If you grew up playing tennis, you have to switch your brain backward. It is really difficult because in tennis, you attack, and in pickleball, you have to stay back, and then you can only attack so far. So if you're expecting to be like what we saw at the U.S. Open, charging out kind of stuff, not going to happen. You just have to kind of learn it and understand it. But Rick and them will teach you. So 5 o'clock on Saturdays. There is one Saturday we may have to change the time on, but we're at least going to start this Saturday so that everybody knows. Okay? Second thing is, as everyone knows, Queen Elizabeth passed away this past week. And because we're starting the NFL today, Keith sent me this very important statistic that during her reign, which was 70 years, that she dealt with 6 different popes, 16 United States presidents. Now, they have a term, we understand that, and 59 starting quarterbacks for the Browns. All right. So everyone take a look at your jersey you're wearing. I'm just kidding. I know it's so exciting, but let me tell you about how sad kind of our society is right now. On my way in, I drive past a church and I drive past a bar. I don't have any choice. That's the main intersection where I'm going. And at 9:15 this morning, 9:17, there were more cars in the bar than there were at the church. Now, here's the thing. The church started, I believe, at 9:30, and I don't think the game goes until 1, so or starts at 1. So here's the thing. I want everyone to understand. We will make sure that we have you out before kickoff every single Sunday. So you can get home, and you can watch it, and we're good to go. Unless there's one of those games. I don't know if they play in Europe this year or not, but over in London, if that happens, there's not a whole lot we can do about that. I think you can actually watch it first and then come here. But just want to make sure so everyone knows. So that we'll get you out. In fact, you'll have an hour, maybe even more, to yourself before the game starts. Okay? So there was the start as we dive in today. And as we dive in today, give me three steps. And so each and every week, we try to bring a message through God's word of things that we can use and things that we can start our week with, because this is the start of our week. So we get to hear about God's word, we get to apply it to our lives, and then hopefully take it out with us. So if we could just have three steps, wouldn't it make it easy on each one of us when it comes to the things that we have to deal with? Whether it's a struggle as we're starting at work, you know, it's the same old job. I don't know why I'm in this job. I've been in this job forever. Maybe it's a new job that you're starting into. You're excited about it. You're a high school student and the new year has started. You're an upperclassman. You've never been an upperclassman before. You're going into high school. You've never been in high school before. You're all of a sudden you're going into college and people are asking you questions about, you know, your life and what it is that you want to do. And all that stuff's way, way, way down the road. We just need to focus on what the day brings us. And for others of us, it's a struggle because we struggle in the relationships that we have, and we struggle in how it is that we speak to the people that we love, or how it is that they speak to us, and the struggles that we have every single day in that. With all the news that we hear, and everything is negative, and war is going on everywhere, and the finances, and the economy, and inflation, and all this stuff that takes place every single day, it's a difficulty sometimes just getting out of bed and taking those next steps forward. So what if we just had three steps? What would those three steps be? And if you're going to have three steps, who would be the people that you would talk to? Who would be the people that you would have the conversation with? Now, some of you would say, well, I would turn to my best friend. Some of you would say, I would turn to my spouse. Some of you would say, I would turn to my spouse. Who is my best friend? Some of you would say, I would turn to a parent. That parent may also be my best friend. And you start to look at the people around us. We start to look at the people in our lives. And we start to realize that, you know what? God may maybe know what it is that he's doing. And sometimes we can't see within the midst of it, but when we follow the three steps that God gives us within his word, and we do this day by day and week by week, and then we can find people that we can relate to, well, that's kind of a game changer. So today, I want you to be thinking about those people that you have within your life. I want you to be thinking about the people that you surround yourself with. I want you to think about the people that you would go to for advice, that you would go to for counsel, that you would go to sit down with and maybe have a cup of coffee with and just talk about life and the things that truly matter. Because what we're going to find is that later today, let's say it's 1 o'clock and there's a kickoff and your favorite team, you know, they kick it off and the other team runs it all the way back. We'll just do this again next year and we'll give up. And many times that's what happens, especially when it comes to a team that we root for. Now, how many people here are Ohio State fans? Okay. How many people here are Notre Dame fans? Okay, Notre Dame is 0-2 right now. And they just lost yesterday at home to a MAC school, which is Marshall. Actually, I don't think Marshall's in the MAC anymore. But anyway, they lost to Marshall at home yesterday. So they're 0-2. The coach from Notre Dame left and he went to LSU. And by him going to LSU, he's actually screwed up two programs all by himself. Because neither one of the programs have a win. I mean, it could change like that. So if we use football as the analogy, we're going to have a season. We're going to have it game by game. But then you have to practice day by day to get to that next week and that next game. So let's start our week so that we're preparing ourselves to get to the next week, and we'll do it with three steps. The example we're going to use today is through a guy by the name of Gideon. And just so that we all know what's happening here, let's talk about it. Israel has not listened to God. They have not focused upon what it is, the steps that they should be taking. And so because of that, God has kind of said, you want to do things your own way? Go ahead and do things your own way. But remember, when you choose to do things your own way, you get everything that comes with it. And so the people that are kind of out doing things their own way, they don't really care because they weren't listening to God before, so they can continue to not listen to God. And so they get caught up in all the things of the world and all the things that are happening. But there's also people that are out there that are focused on God and are focused upon their walk and are very much focusing that, you know what, this matters to me and my spiritual walk and my walk as a believer, my walk knowing that there is a God matters to me. And so for them, it's a little bit different because they keep waiting for God to step in. They keep waiting for God to intervene. And then when he doesn't, they start to wonder why and they can't really get it. And yet if they look around and they start to see things, they realize that our country as a whole, this is the direction they're going. And the direction that they're going is away from God. Even though God promised to help and to guide them, they lost sight of who he is. They lost sight of his power. They lost sight of his love for each one of them. And so it started with one person, it went to another person, and power all of a sudden overtook everything, and the love that God has for us kind of gets put on the back burner. To the point that there's more people that aren't believing, there's more people that aren't focused on their faith than are. But boy, those ones that are, they have to be wondering, what is God up to? What is God doing? When is God going to show up in the way that it is that I expect him to? And so right now at this time, there's a group called the Midianites. And the Midianites have taken over to the point to where everybody is put down when it comes to being an Israelite. And so the people at this time, one of the things that they had to do was they would have to take their crops. And so one of those crops was wheat. And the way that you handle wheat is they take this on a threshing floor and they pound this down. And then the wind picks up the chaff, which is the bad stuff, and it blows it away. The problem was the way to do this is you want to do this on top of a mountain. Because you want to be in a place that is windy. So that when they knock this down and it separates the two, it makes it easier on them when they are working. But every time this would happen, the Midianites would come along and say, hey, thanks for doing all that work. And oh, by the way, we'll go ahead and take all of that grain, all that wheat, all that good stuff that you just got done working so hard for. By the way, did we mention that we're a Midianite? And the person standing there going, I just did all this work, but if I fight against them, if I try to turn against them, it could cost me my life. And it cost my life, it cost my role, and as a provider and all those other kind of things, my family is left on their own. So here's Gideon, and he is picking it up, and he knows that culture has taken over to the point where they have forgotten about God. They feel like they don't really matter. And he has questions, and he has concerns all these things that are going to take place. This is what we're going to dive in today. Give me three steps. Judges 6 says the angel of the Lord came and sat down under the oak. Now let's stop here for 1 second. The reason this is called Judges is because each of the tribes, there's 12 tribes, they are now focused upon themselves. And so rather than having one main king, each of the tribes now has a judge that oversees that particular tribe. So the angel of the Lord came and sat down under the oak where Gideon was threshing wheat in a wine press to keep it from the Midianites. So the wine press, whenever you grow grapes in that, you're not going to grow grapes on top of a mountain. You're going to grow it where the soil is the best, where the water's going to flow through, where the sun's going to hit it just right, and where you can go ahead and pick the grapes and then use those for the wine press. So it's going to be in the lower country. The Midianites know, though, for those that are going to do this with the wheat, the grain, and smacking it and getting rid of all the chaff and the bad stuff, they're going to want to be at the top of the mountain. Gideon knows that. So he is in a wine press in an area where there's not going to be all that wind because he is at the bottom of the mountain. So it's going to be a harder job. So Gideon shows right from the beginning that he is a hard worker, but he is willing to take his role as a person, as a dad, as a husband, as a provider, pick whatever role you want, because he wants to make sure that his family is going to be fed. But he also knows that there's the fear that at any time the Midianites can come in and say, I'm going to take everything that you've just done. All the work that you've just gone ahead and taken hours to do, we'll just go ahead and take that. He knows that that is possible. The issue is, though, here for the Midianites is that they're looking on top of the hill. He's at the bottom of the hill doing his work. So it says, the angel of the Lord came in. He was at the wine press to keep it from the Midianites. Verse 12, when the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, he said, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior. Now we're going to stop here for two reasons, because this is really important. The first thing is, notice what the angel of the Lord said. The angel of the Lord did not say, I am Gabriel. When Gabriel did show it up, Gabriel said, hey, I'm Gabriel. By the way, I'm the angel of the Lord. When it points out here, it says, the Lord is with you. This is what's known as a Christophany. This is where Jesus shows up in the Old Testament, but doesn't announce himself as Jesus. If you go back to the beginning, in the beginning was the Word, in the beginning, and made in our image, Jesus showed up in the Old Testament. He's just not fully man at this point. He is in the spirit type form, and people would see this as being an angel. This is Jesus. This is Jesus sitting with Gideon. So it says, the Lord is with you, and look what he calls him, mighty warrior. Now, if we're paying attention to the story that just took place, it doesn't really seem like Gideon's all that mighty of a warrior. Because wouldn't the mighty warrior say, you know what? I'm going to go to the top of the mountain. I'm going to go ahead and thresh this wheat, grain, all that kind of stuff. I'm going to have 6 or 7 of my closest buddies sitting in the rocks ready to go. And then when I start doing this and the Midian shows up, we're going to start taking them out one by one. Because that's how a warrior works. And that's how this warrior is going to work. And yet, he's hiding. He's at the bottom of the hill. He's doing the work where he shouldn't be doing it. And he's doing whatever he can just to take care of his family, friends, all that kind of stuff. He can't be feeling like a mighty warrior at this point. And yet when Jesus speaks to him, Jesus sees him in a way that he can't see. And so for all of us, how is it that you think that God would look at you? If Jesus were to give you a title, what do you think that title might be? Child of God, son of God, daughter of God. I am with you to the end. I am with you. The Lord here was with Gideon. And when Jesus left, he said, I am with you always, giving you power and authority. Do we walk in such a way so that when, even though we look at ourselves and we don't see the greatness that God has in us, even when we don't see that he's walking alongside of us, even though we don't see that he is with us, that he can overcome everything. When's the last time that you looked in the mirror, thought of yourself as being a mighty warrior? Even when you don't have weapons. Even when you don't have a shield. Even when you're not walking in armor. And yet throughout the New Testament, we get these pictures. Put on the armor every single day. Make sure that you have the breastplate. Make sure you're putting on the helmet. Make sure you're putting on the shoes. Make sure you have the shield. Make sure you're carrying your weapon with you. And that weapon, all of those, it's the Word of God. And so every day we have the opportunity to walk as a mighty warrior. Do we walk that way? Do we think that way? When it comes to our faith, does our faith elevate so that others can see that through us? Because we are challenged to do so. So guess what? When God looks at you, he looks at you in such a way that you can't see yourself. You've never thought of yourself. If I'm getting at this point, I'm like mighty warrior or guy that's hiding in the wine press, you know, just hoping to get through the day and not getting beat up by the Midianites. See, God sees all and he knows all, and he already knows what Gideon is going to become. He knows the potential that Gideon has. He knows the potential that you and I have, and he sees so much more in us. But too many times, because everything that's taking place in the world, with our busyness of life, with our schedules, with our poor choices, with our past, with all the things that we hold on to, with all the things that rise from within, we don't look at ourselves as God looks at ourselves. So before we get to three steps, let's all know this. If we're going to walk in our faith, if we're going to choose to walk in our faith, if we're going to not do what everyone else does just because everyone else is doing it, or that's a stage of life and so that's kind of okay, and then maybe the next time or maybe the next year or maybe the next day, maybe then I'll really start focusing on God. God sees you as a mighty warrior. Let's start walking like one. Let's make that choice. Even when we can't see it in ourselves. And now the conversation between the Lord and Gideon has started. And now each and every day we choose, starting with this week, starting on this day with Sunday at the beginning of our week, we choose how we're going to have that conversation every day with God and then every day with others. But it starts with the conversation with the Lord. Here it continues. Next verse. Pardon me, my Lord, Gideon replied. But if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all his wonders that our ancestors told us about when they said, did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? But now the Lord has abandoned us and given us into the hand of Midian. That's a fair question. Hey, listen, you know, you're saying this, but like, I've got some questions about this. Know this. We don't see ourselves as a mighty warrior. We don't consider ourselves as a mighty warrior. But instead, we get stuck when it comes to all the stuff that's going around us, and we don't understand why we're not elevated above it. Ask God about it. That's the first thing. You want your first step? Ask God these questions. It's okay to ask him. Talk to him about it. Have a discussion. Lord, you're seeing me as a mighty warrior, but man, everyone else is getting ahead. That guy's getting promoted. That person's done everything wrong, and yet I'm paying for it. Those people over there, they took out loan after loan after loan, and yet now it's going to hit my taxes? This doesn't make sense to me. There's question after question we have within this society. It's okay to ask God these questions. And here's why. If we're going to be a mighty warrior, it starts with us having this discussion. A discussion is a two-way road. And God has challenged us to have this discussion with him. And it is okay. So Gideon recognizes that this is the Lord. And he starts with step number one, saying this: I've got some questions, God. There's some things I'm really not quite understanding here. And it's okay to ask the questions. The conversation continues. Next verse. The Lord turned to him and said, so here we go. Here's the conversation. Go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you? To which, if I'm Gideon, I'm like, oh, hold on a second. Listen, I just had some questions about stuff. And like, yeah, I know you see me as a mighty warrior. I don't have any weapons. I don't have a sword. I don't have that kind of stuff. And what do you mean you're sending me? God did not intend for us to just sit and soak. He sends us. We come here to grow, and then we go. We come here to learn, and then we go in love. We come here to spend some time within his word, and then we have to go out and live that word before others. So being a warrior means God is going to send you into the battle, no matter what that battle might be. It could be with your friends. It could be at school. It could be at work. It could be within your community. It could be dealing with ex-relationships. It could be dealing with current relationships. It could be dealing with family. If we're going to be a warrior, we have to be willing to bring our faith to the fight. So God continues the conversation. He says, am I not sending you? Jesus discipled the disciples for 3 years, and then what did he do? He sent them out two by two. And the disciples became apostles. We learn as disciples, and then we become apostles by taking out the message. Right here with Gideon, it's like a 30-second conversation. Hey, and by the way, I'm sending you out. He didn't get 3 years, did he? Why is that? He was probably preparing for years and years and years, and he was waiting for this moment because this is how it was taught during this culture. So now they're having a good discussion. Verse 15, watch how Gideon handles it. Pardon me, my Lord, I just want to, you know, make sure that we're still talking about this. First of all, you're looking at me as a warrior, and now you're going to be sending me out. Pardon me, my Lord, but how can I save Israel? How can little old me save this big old country? How can little old me, the guy that's hiding down here in the wine press, how is it that I can save your chosen people? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh. So out of all the clans, you're picking the weakest clan. We're in Clinton, Ohio. Did you guys know that demographically, geographically, all that within Summit County, this is the poorest part of all of Summit County. Right where we're at. It's a struggle here financially. It's a struggle all around. Different rules and things that they have to go through. It's just a struggle where we're at. But we can look at ourselves as being the weakest, or we can look at ourselves as being the brightest light up on a hill to reach our communities and reach the people around us that God cares about and that we care about. So how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh. And here we go. Are you ready for this? And I am the least in my family. Which to me is Gideon's way of saying, hey, you know what? I'm really not qualified. I'm not your guy. Let's go back to the beginning. When you called me a mighty warrior, I'm the least of the least. So I don't think it makes sense for you to pick me. When we take a step as a believer, when we ask Jesus into our heart, he has given us eternity. Doesn't it just make sense that we can give him a little back, a little bit back every day to show the gift that he's given us? He gave us 100%. So can't we give him 100% of who we are each day? Or can't we at least try? So here we go. He says, can I save Israel? Michael, go back. I'm sorry. My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family. So here's the next thing. It's okay to ask questions, and it's okay to doubt your qualifications. There's an old saying that goes, God does not call the qualified. I have to make sure I have this right. God does not call the qualified. He qualifies the called. Perfect example of it are the disciples. Once again, they were not the best of the best. They were the leftovers. And yet God started his church and built everything upon them, even after they were losing their lives. He does not call the qualified. He qualifies the called. And here's what's funny. It's like for me, like when I came in here as a church, they wanted to know, hey, do you have the proper education? What is the proper education? Well, you need to have a four-year degree. I have a four-year degree. And you need to have a master's in some kind of religious theological studies. Well, I'm almost finished with it. I'm actually getting my master's in divinity. Oh, okay. Well, then you're qualified. Well, qualified for what? Where does that show that in the Bible? What am I qualified for? What are you qualified for? When you take a step of belief, you are qualified to represent a God that loves you. You are qualified to bring peace and to share hope. You are qualified to love as Jesus loved others. And you are qualified to make disciples in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And in return, Jesus says this, I'll never leave you nor forsake you, mighty warrior. Are we acting like that mighty warrior? Because we stop too many times with saying, I just don't really have the qualifications. And so because of that, we get out in the battle. We never go out and challenge ourselves to live our faith. We just stop. Watch how the conversation continues. The Lord answered, I will be with you, and you will strike down all the Midianites, leaving none alive. Now, we'll get into the whole life and death thing at another time as far as having a discussion. But God told him this. I'm with you, and I'm not leaving you. So if you want to question your qualifications, go ahead. If you want to say, I'm not old enough, I'm not pretty enough, I'm not tall enough, I don't have enough education, I don't know all the right words, I don't know all the words between in the beginning and amen. Jesus said this, love others as I loved others, love your neighbor as you love yourself, and just go and make disciples in my name. Because once again, I'm not leaving you. I give you all power and authority. When? Until the end. So all of us are in the midst, and all of us are his mighty warriors, and all of us have questions at times, and all of us question our qualifications. But see, when we question those qualifications, you know who we take them to? We take them to God. God, I just don't know that I'm good enough. I don't think that I'm good enough. And none of us are going to be good enough ever. None of us are going to be perfect. But it's striving toward it and having these conversations and then having that plan. That was step two. And here is step three. Gideon replied. Remember, this is the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, people focused upon the sacrifices. This is how things were done. Gideon replied, "If now I have found favor in your eyes, give me a sign that is really you talking to me." Isn't that what we all want? All right, God, if this is you, give me a sign. And then we wait and we pause. Now, in our mind, what is that sign going to be? You know, he'll strike lightning. You know, he'll part the sea before us. You know, he'll crack out an earthquake where we can all see it. You know, all of a sudden my car didn't start all day, and all of a sudden it'll start. And as I'm driving, I realized I was driving a 1986 Honda Accord, and now all of a sudden I'm driving a Lamborghini. I mean, what kind of sign is it that we need? We need that, like, visual sign, right? Because that way, then we would know that it is God. Watch what happens here. "Please do not go away until I come back and bring my offering and set it before you." So Gideon is saying this: I'm going to bring what it is that I have to you. I'm going to offer this as a sacrifice. So wait right here, because I want to know for sure that this is you. And the Lord said, "I will wait until you return." Once again, they're having a conversation. Next verse. Gideon went inside, prepared a young goat, and from an ephah of flour, he made bread without yeast. The yeast, by the way, that represents evil. So by not having any yeast in it, there's no evil here. Putting the meat in a basket and its broth in a pot, he brought them out and offered that to him under the oak. So he's offering this to God. Verse 20, the angel of God said to him, "Take the meat and the unleavened bread, place them on this rock and pour out the broth." And Gideon did so. So in other words, I'm going to give you the instructions. You follow the instructions. You got to trust me. Next verse. Then the angel of the Lord touched the meat and the unleavened bread with the tip of the staff. The tip of the staff shows this isn't just the angel of the Lord. This is the Lord. That's the shepherd. The shepherd has his staff that was in his hand. Fire flared from the rock, consuming the meat and the bread, and the angel of the Lord disappeared. In other words, what that means is, here's your sacrifice. It was accepted. Now, is it okay for us to ask for a sign? Absolutely. But if you're asking for a sign, and that just happened to you, and you're alone with just God, do you want to go tell that story to your friends? Do you want to go share that with your wife? Dude, you're not going to believe what just happened. And then you tell the whole thing, and they're like, have you been smoking some of the things in the back there, the new plants that are growing up in the back? Wouldn't you think that they would think that you're crazy? Wouldn't you think that you were crazy? You'd be like, what in the world just happened? See, in the Old Testament, because of the sacrifice system and because of what had taken place, the things like this would happen at times. But God gives us signs all over the place, and we have to look for areas of confirmation. This past week, my nephew called me. He said, "Uncle John, do you have a few minutes to talk?" I'm like, "Absolutely, I have a few minutes to talk. Let's have a conversation." And he starts sharing with me something about something that's taking place within this world that's happened all over the place. And he goes, "I just want to know what your thoughts are on it. From a biblical standpoint, where is it that I should stand?" And so we had a whole conversation about what's going on with the world, what is the world chooses to do, this is what's going on from a biblical standpoint. And then he said, "Well, what is it that you would do?" And I said, "Well, let me tell you something, Nathan. First off, the thing that you're doing," this is not my son, Nathan, this is my nephew, Nathan. "First off, the thing that you're doing," as we were having this conversation, "is the right thing to do. I wasn't the first person he turned to. I was the third. But each one of them, this is who he turned to. I'm turning to people that love God. I'm turning to people that know his word. And I'm turning to people that aren't going to point me to what the world says, but what God's word says." So if you want confirmation, you got to have a conversation. Ooh, write that down. If you want confirmation, you got to have a conversation. And if you want to have a conversation, if you're going to have that conversation, you got to come back to where you're going to get the confirmation. You need, and I need to take this battle daily with people around me and people I can talk to when it comes up with my battle. Because, hey, I want to have a conversation. I had a conversation with God, and I think I might be a little bit crazy, but I know that you love God, and you love the Lord, and you will point me to his word. Am I doing the right thing here? Is this the right step to take? And there are going to be times when maybe it isn't the right step. There's going to be times when it's going to be really, really difficult. There's going to be times of, man, this is fun, but man, is it really going to help me for the long term? There's going to be times where, is this really what God wants me to do when it comes to my faith? Is this really what's going to play out if I'm going to be a mighty warrior? See, what Gideon didn't have is what we do have, a place where we can turn to have confirmation. What Gideon didn't have, obviously, around him that we also have is we have a church family or people in our lives that we can turn to that are going to point us here. They love the Lord. They love us no matter what. They love his word. God bless you. They point to his word, and they have your best interests, not their own, at heart. So give me three steps. Give me three steps. It's okay to ask questions to God. It's okay. It's really okay. It's okay to think that you're not completely qualified and to tell God about that. God, I don't think I'm the best person, but wait, you think I'm the right person? Okay, I may not be completely qualified. But then it's also okay to go out and find that confirmation. No, you aren't the biggest. No, you aren't the strongest. No, you aren't the boss. No, you aren't the supervisor. No, you don't have the final say. No, it's probably not, you know, the right place at the exact right time. But I'll tell you what, it's a great opportunity for you to show your faith before others. Mighty warrior. Because the warrior is the one who, when they're sent out, they choose to get into the battlefield. And they choose to believe that God can conquer all. And they choose God before all with the people around them. So challenge yourself this week to be that mighty warrior. Ask the questions. Even when you don't feel qualified, go and into his word, find confirmation. Seek people around you that will help you with that confirmation. And then choose to get into the battle, because God is sending you and I out every single day. And when you leave this church today and you read that sign above it that says you are now entering your mission field, go be the best believer, the best person living their faith, and that mighty warrior that God seeks in each one of us and God sees in each and every one of us. Now, right where you sit, if you just bow your head and close your eyes for a moment, praise team is going to come up and sing this final song. And it's a song of worship that we lift our hearts and our minds and our voices up to God. But right where you sit today, I'm sure that you have questions. And your questions may be different than my questions. Right where you sit today, you want to do more, but you're like, oh, I don't know that I'm qualified. And so maybe if I just do this, maybe I take the next step and the next step and you know, whatever that next step might be. And then. God didn't put a pause button on Gideon. Would you have the conversation with God? And even though you may not be what you feel is the perfect person for whatever it is he's having you battle, seek that confirmation through his word and through others that love the Lord, that love you, and that have your best interests at heart as his mighty warrior. Heavenly Father, each one of us wants to live our faith. But God, our worlds all look different. Sometimes it's a busyness, sometimes it's a craziness, sometimes it's just the mundane, sometimes it's the same old, same old. And yet, Lord, you're there through all of it. God, you see us in such a special way, and for some reason we can't see that. And a lot of times it's because we get caught up in all of the things that are taking place around us. God, it wears us down. It beats us up. Man, it's heavy. And you never intended that for any of us. God, instead, what you intended for all of us is love, peace, hope. Peace, hope, love. Hope, love, peace, in whatever order. Because God, they all point back to you. So God, this week, challenge us to recognize who you are in our life. Challenge us to ask questions. Challenge us to go through our qualifications, and even when they don't seem like they're good enough, that God will take it to you and before others who can help us in the battle. And God, help us to hold on to the fact that when you look at us, you see a mighty warrior. And we are a mighty warrior because we have you in our hearts. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your many blessings. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Would you all please rise? If you don't bow your heads and close your eyes for one more moment here. If you've never stopped long enough to take that step of faith, that step to where you step and ask God into your heart as your personal Savior, so that you become a child of God. And as a child of God, you become a mighty warrior. He wants you to be that child first. Where we stop long enough to recognize God for who God is. Where we stop long enough and say, God, you sent your son Jesus for me. Little old me. I don't get it at times because I don't know that I'm worth it. And God says this, you qualify. You qualify because you are recognizing me as God. And you are stopping long enough to ask me into your heart as your personal Savior. Just admitting you need him. Believing that God sent his son Jesus for you, and then committing to walk with him as a child of God. If you've never stopped long enough to ask him into your heart, and today's that day that you want to do so, please raise your hand right where you stand. Okay, now I want everyone to look at me here real quick. There's two things that you're going to take with you today. One of two. Some of you are going to walk out going, I'm a mighty warrior. And some of you are going to walk out and go, there's been 59 quarterbacks since Queen Elizabeth was in reign. Please don't take that with you, even during kickoff. To be a mighty warrior, ask God questions. You're having a conversation. To be a mighty warrior, it's okay your own qualifications and take it before God. But seek that confirmation through his word and through people that love the Lord and that love you. And let's get into the battle, because after this verse, we're sending out. Have a great week. Let's finish with this final verse once again. And I know what everyone wants to hear right now. We're going to finish with, go Steelers. Actually, go Browns. Go enjoy it.
Glad to see you all here this morning. Just a few announcements for you. First of all, we have a very strong need for volunteers. If any of you are in the workforce or have been somewhere where you see a sign closed, lack of staffing, well, we have that struggle here as well. You can imagine that if you can't pay employees that want to work, volunteers are even harder to get. We are desperately seeking for volunteers in our Sunday school classes to teach. You don't have to do it every Sunday. You can on schedule, and the sign-up sheet is out on the chalkboard in the lobby. If this is something that God is directing you to do, I ask that you just follow him and go out there and put your name on that list, and we'll be in touch with you to be a Sunday school teacher, because our children, they're not getting this Jesus stuff anywhere else, and they need to get it from us. So I ask that you please pray about this. And we can use anybody that wants to step forward to help. Our Bible studies are back in full swing beginning this week. Wednesday night Bible study is an open Bible study for anybody who would like to attend. It is at 6:30 to 8. You folks that attend this study have some homework to do this week. Thank you, Mr. Don. He's assigning you homework. You have finished your Revelation study, and Don would like you to come up with some ideas of what you would like to study next. So be thinking about it, praying about it. Show up on Wednesday with your ideas and suggestions, and Don will take it from there. This week on Thursday, our men's study and our women's study will begin at 6:30 to 8 o'clock. The men will be in the front room behind us here. The women will be in the back room, and the women will be studying the faithful. So if you haven't got your book, or if your book is lost somewhere on the Amazon truck like mine, go ahead and show up anyway. We'll work through it. Thank you and have a great day.